Hello, everybody. Paul Cheon here. And this week, we get to turn back the clock a little bit. And, you know, I've really been enjoying Randy Buehler's kind of turn back the clock gauntlet series that Magic Online has provided with us. And this format is likely the standard format that I've played the most, because this was kind of around the time where I was in college and I had a ton of time. And so basically, you know, I would spend many, many hours playing standard. And this was one of my favorite decks. This is actually one of the decks that I started playing. My first deck that I played was Blue-Green Madness, my first competitive deck. And then I kind of made the shift over to Psychatog as well. And this deck was a delight. Now, the way this deck works, for all of you people who didn't play back when Psychatog was one of the best decks, is that's your win condition. You have Psychatog. You can discard a card to give it +1/+1, or exile two cards from your graveyard, you get +1/+1 until end of turn. And that does that by one of two ways. You can either kill your opponent by drawing a ton of cards and filling and having a huge graveyard, or if you can float enough mana, you can play Upheaval, then play Psychatog. And then if you do that, oftentimes you're going to have to discard a bunch of cards and you're going to have a full grip to be basically kill your opponent. So let's quickly go over the deck here. We have, of course, our mana base. We have our blue-black lands that were legal at the time, Underground River and Salt Marsh, a bunch of islands and swamps. We have Cephalid Coliseum because you often have Threshold, because you do have a lot of cheap interaction. And this does help you kind of find whatever cards you might need and also helps you pump up your Psychatog. Then we have our two drops here. No one drops in this deck, but we have some fantastic two drops. We have Counterspell. Just old school Counterspell. Can you imagine if this existed in the current standard? Oh, don't even. I'm so excited. Just words. No words. Counterspell, just amazing. Cheap way to answer all threats. We have Memory Lapse as well. Nice way to kind of buy time. You know how people play Commit? Yeah, imagine 2-mana Commit. I know this doesn't bounce permanents, but it costs 2 mana. And then we have Removal in Chainer's Edict. Then we have 4 copies of Nightscape Familiar. And this is the reason why, if you look, this is a control deck that only plays 24 lands. The reason being is you have Nightscape Familiar. What Nightscape Familiar does is, for this deck at least, is it makes your blue spells cost 1 less mana. It can also regenerate, it can beat people down. But for the most part, you're playing it because it can make blue spells cost 1 less. And so, basically, it kind of acts as a mana rock, if you will. It acts as, you know, it's a Sapphire Medallion or Dimir Signet, however you want to call it. But that's what this deck, what this card does. And there are a lot of blue spells that do benefit from this. You have your Togs, your Memory Lapse. I mean, playing a 1-mana Memory Lapse does kind of feel like cheating. Turn 3 Knights get familiar with 1 blue up. Repulses, Cunning Wishes, etc. We have more Counter Magic and Circular Logic, which is, you know, again, this deck fills up its graveyard pretty well. And you can also Madness it out with the Psychatog. We have, of course, our win condition. We have a really, really nice bounce spell and repulse. They just don't print this kind of card anymore. You have the fixed repulse and Gale Strike, but 2 and a blue, unconditional. Return target creature to its owner's hand, draw a card. Really nice card. You know, if you play against even a deck with a lot of removal, you can even use it to save your own Psychatogs. And of course, with Familiar, it costing 2 is a big game. We have more card draw and Factor Fiction, Deep Analysis. And I don't know if you ever got to cast this card. This card is amazing. Guaranteed to get you 3 cards at the very worst. It could just be bad cards, but it allows you to kill people on the spot with Psychatog, and it really messes up math. If you attack with 6 cards in hand and the ability to cast Factor Fiction, your opponents might have to just start chump blocking from that point on. So Factor Fiction, very, very good card. And you're like, well, Paul, why is Factor Fiction only a 3 of in the main deck if it's so good? Well, we got Cunning Wish. Cunning Wish allows us to cast an instant out of our sideboard. And so let's go over our sideboard here. We have, of course, Deep Analysis as more card draw and Upheaval, which is a way to, again, float mana and cast Psychatog for the win. So our Cunning Wish targets here, we have Factor Fiction. This effectively allows us to have 6 copies of Factor Fiction in our deck. We have 1 copy of Recoil as a catch-all. You know, sometimes you need to bounce a Squirrel Nest or I would say Planeswalker, but Planeswalkers didn't exist at the time. But, you know, this deck has a lot of counter magic. So if something like a Lightning Rift or an Astral Slide resolves, you can wish for Recoil, then counter it when they try to play it again. Slay, excellent card against green decks. Destroy target green creature, draw a card. against other decks with counter magic. If you're trying to set up the upheaval kill, you can also play Mana Short. You can Cutting Wish for Mana Short. On your opponent's upkeep or end step, you can basically tap them down so that you can ensure that you resolve Upheaval plus Psychatog. One copy of Hibernation for various green decks. Very, very swingy card. Teferi's Response, counter target ability or spell an opponent controls that targets a land you control. If a permanent's ability is countered this way, destroy that permanent, draw two cards. So, what are some great ways to that this thing great cards that this thing counters? Well, one of the common things that people play is opposition. And what people will do is try to opposition your land on your upkeep. Now, what you can do is counter that ability with Teferi's Response, and then you can destroy the opposition. Let me just read it one more time just to make sure I don't sound silly. Counter target spell or ability, an opponent control that targets a land you control. If a permanent's ability is countered this way, destroy a target permanent. Yes. Also, you know, if people play land destruction, obviously this is also very good there. Then we have one copy of Gainsay against other blue decks. You can wish for, basically, this is like your counter spell. You have Ghastly Demise, cheap, efficient removal spell. Oftentimes you board in two, and you'll have a third in the sideboard, very, very cheap, efficient removal there. Four copies of Duress in the sideboard. Of course, you can't wish for this, but it's an excellent card against other control decks. And then one copy of Coffin Purge for various graveyard strategies. This was a card that existed when Reanimator was a deck, but that's not in the Gauntlet, so this card is not quite as good, but it's still there in the sideboard. Now, one thing you can do with these Gauntlet decks is add or change around your main decks, but I'm going to be a purist, and I'm going to keep the deck as is, and head into a queue. Alrighty, we have a hand with Interaction, card draw, I'm keeping. We are on the draw, which is always worse, but our opponent did mulligan here. Man, where's my Temple of Deceit? It's okay. Unnecessary evil to cast your spell. We're playing against a blue deck, but there are a lot of blue decks. Okay, well, blue and black means we are playing against Psychatog. Now I'm going to play the Underground River here over the Swamp because we do have Counterspell, and if we draw a Counterspell, I want to play the Salt Marsh next turn. Let's go ahead and use Chainer's Edict here. Our hand is pretty great, but it does take us a while to win. So if our opponent just draws a bunch of lands, definitely still in this. Actually, they could just play a Psychatog here. Since I have access to the Memory Lapse, I'm just going to play the tap land. But that's a good sign. Very unlikely that our opponent has a second blue source here. Because I imagine they would have played it to represent Counterspell. Here we go. So, my opponent could be playing could have Circular Logic here. So I don't think I want to run out the Factor Fiction just yet, at least until before the turn, where I'm going to miss a land drop. Now that I drew the sixth land, I can play Factor Fiction with Memory Lapse backup. Okay, my opponent drew the second blue. Is this just a deep analysis? We'll let that resolve. As now we get to resolve our Factor Fiction and possibly play a threat this turn as well. Wow! That's a good hand. I'm probably going to keep Counterspell anything. I don't think my opponent's going to do a 4-1 split here. I might get Counterspell Repulse. Oh, no. Okay. Well, so I'll have 8 cards. Yeah. I feel like I have enough card draw. So I'd rather just have, oftentimes you want to just load up your hand with hard counter spells. And I'm probably just going to go ahead and discard a Repulse here. I don't want to play Deep Analysis because I'm just going to have to discard more cards. I just want to make sure I can keep hitting my land drops. I do want to start running out counter spells though, so that, let's see, do I want to, or do I just want to repulse that? I'm just going to bounce it actually. Interesting that my opponent's not going for deep analysis. Like, missing land drops is so bad. This is going to make them discard as well. If my opponent counters back, I might actually just want to repulse it again. So what is being memory lapsed? My repulse is being memory lapsed. I guess that is okay. I'm doing this to try to hit a land drop. I could have also cast Deep Analysis. That was pretty lucky, I'm not gonna lie. Yeah. I could play Deep Analysis this turn, but I'd rather just keep up counter magic. If my opponent could randomly run out of Psychatog, and I might not have... No, I have Chainer's Edict for the answer, but... Let's see. Let's just lapse that. Memory lapse, targeting memory lapse. We'll let that happen. I don't mind drawing memory lapse, so I'll just lapse it again. It just buys me time. And this prevents my opponent from hitting land drops. I guess they could have drawn a land this turn. Let's cast Deep Analysis. Hit a land. And I think I want to wait a turn for the Psychatog. I could play Deep Analysis this turn. Like, how bad is it if my opponent resolves Knightscape Familiar? Not that bad, so let's go ahead and do that. So yeah, things are looking quite good for us. We're just so far ahead on cards. I mean, okay, so my opponent did have the third memory lapse. Okay. So let's see here. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I do kind of want to get this off the board, but at the same time, I can just place Familiar Psychatog. Yeah, I think I'd rather do that. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I probably shouldn't be playing any more lands, but... I mean, playing lands does allow me to just hard cast Chainer's Edict, which is nice. My opponent might opt to Deep Analysis here. And, like, I don't really need the Knightscape Familiar, so if my opponent plays something like a Chainer's Edict, I'll probably let it resolve. Just sacrifice the Familiar. Another thing we could do if my opponent wanted to cast a spell is activate the Cephalid Colosseum, and with the Madness, play out the Circular Logic. And we'll let that happen. Like, my Psychatog isn't lethal anytime soon. So, all right, play Psychatog, 3, 4, 5, 6, 3, 4, 5, 6, yeah. So if my opponent opts to just hard cast Logic here, that's not that bad for me, as I can just pay for it. Do you have another repulse? Okay. All right. I mean, this Familiar is definitely doing a lot of work. And I tapped in. Did I tap incorrectly? Yeah, I could have had an extra blue up. So I don't think it's going to matter here because we have so many different counters in our hand. But yeah, it's one thing to keep in mind. Memory lapsing flashback spells is pretty nice. Circular logic. Targeting memory lapse. So now the question is it worth countering this deep analysis? Do I actually want to do this? No, you can have your two cards. Yeah, maybe I should have been a little more aggressive with killing this Nightscape Familiar. My opponent is catching up in cards. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Actually, if I do draw land, well, let's see what they do here. I think they might be tempted to play Psychatog. And let's just go ahead and counter that. And they can't have any more counters as they used all three memory lapses and they have the Underground River up. So do we have lethal 9? I feel like my opponent might have... Ooh, that was a good one. Yeah, my opponent, I think, has to block Psychatog. Or maybe not. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, plus 5, 17. Yeah, they do have to block Psychotop. So yeah, we're in a great spot here. There's nothing they can really do. As I mentioned before, there's no real 1-drops in the deck. The 2-drops are the Memory Lapses, Chainer's Edicts, and Nightscape Familiars, and Counter Spells. And they used all their Memory Lapses, so. My opponent does have to chump block Psychotop here. Dr. Teeth, oh yeah. Again, I can do this math kind of quickly just because I've played this deck so much before. Really? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, plus 5, 16, but I can Colosseum. I think my opponent's best bet is just to hope that I don't have lethal. But, of course, we do. All right. It's more than enough. Unless there's somehow if my opponent just gets me somehow with fortunately I know the deck lists, but if they just somehow get me, I'd be pretty sad. I would be pretty sad. All right, let's keep exiling. Actually, can I do this faster? I'm surprised my opponent just didn't block the Psychotog because they were literally dead on board. Alright. Anyways, sideboarding. This does get a little more interesting. Ghastly Demise is clearly bad. There's this interesting thing when you have these Cunning Wish sideboards. Oftentimes you want to oftentimes you want to bring in a bunch of these cards because they're good in the matchup, but like you want to wish for them as well. So these are like all cards you want to cunning wish for, depending on the situation. So we got to figure out what we want to do with all of this stuff here. This is kind of interesting. I think I want Chainer's Edict just as a hard way to remove familiars and psychotogs. The question is like how many repulses do I want versus like a card like Memory Lapse, which is annoying, but the games do go kind of longer. So maybe I don't want a card like Memory Lapse in the matchup. This is where I would have to like, if I could phone a friend and just call up Kai and be like, yo, how are you sideboard? Like, the one cool thing about repulse is you can use it to, like, save your own creatures off of Chainer's Edict. But, of course, Edict just permanently makes that resolve. Alright, well, let's try no repulses and see how it goes. I'm not 100% that this is correct. It's either Memory Lapse could maybe even consider shaving an upheaval, but... let's try this. All right. Small again. And we're all right. So Kai told me a completely different sideboard strategy, which I will use for game three, if there is a game three. I kept this because we're on the draw with the Scry, and we have like multiple Lightscape Familiars here, which helps us. But he basically said just to not play the Cunning Wishes, which is pretty interesting. And all right, well, this might be a quick game. And his logic for Cunning Wish being much worse now is the fact that back then you could exile instants with Psychatog and then Cunning Wish for them again. And with the rules change, of course, that doesn't work anymore. Deep analysis. I'll take a land here. Or Psychatog. Okay. Am I getting edicted here? My opponent can also flashback deep analysis. Ooh. Happy with that draw. Let's see. Do I just run out another familiar or do I play a Psychatog? I don't want to play Deep Analysis because I was going to have to discard, and this is kind of an attrition matchup. And we're lower on resources, so I don't really want to trade Nightscape Familiars either. Main phase Foff. Alright, so Counterspell is the best card here. I don't want to give Counterspell plus Edict. Edict is kind of annoying. I could just go Counterspell and two lands. I don't know if my opponent wants the lands. But let's see, if they do that, take that pile, they can still flashback the Edict. Hmm. Let's go like Counterspell and a land. Okay. We're gonna have to fight through a lot of stuff. Okay, so there's a Trainer's Edict. And actually, I could play a Psychatog this turn. And the only thing, like, my opponent can lapse me. That's the only edict that I've seen. They can't flash it back. Or do I want to, like, try to continue developing my board? Eh, maybe that's still better. I feel like this Psychatog is so unlikely to get me there that I'd rather just make sure I continue hitting my land drops. All right. Four, five, six, seven. Now we get kind of in that dangerous territory where my opponent could always just like play Upheaval Psychatog. So. I think I might play Cunning Wish here just to kind of bait a counter. You know, of course, if my opponent plays something, then I can try to counter. I do like Memory Lapsing, Flashback, Deep Analysis. Is this getting counterspelled? Oh, okay. All right. Yeah, my opponent's up 8 cards on me right now. Jeez. Okay, so no Psychatog. Let's see. I could try pulling out my own Psychatog. But no. I think I'd rather just cast Chainer's Edict here. I wonder if this gets countered. Huh. Repulse. Yep. Cute. So Repulse is still under deck, but I see Chainer's Edict. I'm trying to figure out what they... If I get Memory Lapsed, I have no idea. Oh, okay, so they boarded out the Wishes. Okay. Well, at least I got Gainsaid instead of just like Memory Lapsed or whatever. Yeah, this game's probably over. There's a Chainer's Edict in the yard. I think my best bet is just bluffing something here. The problem is if I counter back, my Psychatog resolves, they flashback Chainer's Edict and they kill me. So I think my best bet is to just hope my opponent doesn't go all in with Psychatog and represent Repulse. Coffin Purge? What? Interesting. An interesting one. I guess if I'm like just playing deep analysis, you know, you get something. But yeah, I mean, I just lost because my opponent buried me in card advantage, which is basically what happened in game one. I imagine my opponent has a bunch of hard counters in hand right now. It's 11 damage. Okay. That was really weird. I mean, like, my opponent does have a million counter spells here anyways, but again, that was still really weird. So they also have Cunning Wish? I mean, I imagine I get countered here, and it's probably the game, but... Also, my opponent tapped too much. You do not need to tap the fifth mana. But at this point, we need to hope my opponent has nothing, and for me to draw a mana source that doesn't make me take damage. Discarding Upheaval? So this last card is a logic. Okay. Yeah, this attack made no sense, really. Like... But I'm still going to lose. But it's okay. Okay. Alright. So I'm going to try Kai's sideboard strategy here. He's just said, board them out. And just board in those cards. And he also suggested that if I get the Battle of Wits deck, I can board down to a 60 card deck and you can build a really sweet 60 card deck out of that 250 card pool. That is just way too much thinking. Alright. Okay, let's try this. It's kind of an awkward hand, but... see what you're working with here. Counter edict gainsay repulse. Actually, I can see this. What am I doing? Let's take the Fuff. Salt Marsh turn one. I mean, oh, it's a duress. Should I take the duress or the counterspell? The thing is, my opponent's probably going to fire off duress right now, and it gets my counterspell, so would I rather have a counterspell against his counterspell? Or just go to top deck wars? No, I want to do this, because if my opponent takes my counterspell... I think I'm okay with that. I mean, they could also wait on the duress potentially. Okay, no. Yeah, counterspell was like not a great draw there. Alright. That counterspell was a good draw. So whoever just draws more card draw effects wins. This is where the Cunning Wish isn't bad, because you can wish for Fof, but it is like mana inefficient. Like, I'm trying to envision this being a Cunning Wish and we could get like a Factor Fiction, but whatever, having a mana short's also fine. We're hitting our land drops. The card we want to find, we want the most right now, is Deep Analysis, because we do have to fight through a Gainsay. And I don't want to fire off that duress until I have to. So if I counter this, my opponent is going to gainsay me. But I do have the mana to Flashback Edict. Actually, they might not gainsay me. Alright, so give me an untapped land here. Oh man. Wow, and a counterspell? Alright. Chainer's Edict and a Repulse. I mean, we're not close to dying, so it's not that bad. My opponent, I just have to be mindful of the fact that my opponent can save their Psychatog. Oh, this works actually. I get to mana short my opponent and then Flashback Chainer's Edict. My opponent can't really float mana, so there's that. And my opponent has an Edict and a Repulse, and I have 7 lands in play. And we 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, let's just get it off the board while we can. I know we lose threshold, but you know, we can get that back very easily by casting this duress. Oh, the classic control mirror. Although we haven't found any card draw effects. Neither of us have. Well, my opponent, I guess, had a fact or fiction. This feels like a fact or fiction. I don't know why. Oh, no. Okay. That's a little better, I guess. So I'm keeping this land in my hand now because all I need to do is fire off the rest to get threshold. Okay, so my opponent has a Foff. Are they going to main phase Foff? No. This is why I held the rest. Even if they have the Foff, I can cast the rest later. So now we'll duress our opponent, force them to factor fiction, and then... So do I just go three lands versus these two cards? My opponent probably takes three lands. Is that okay? I mean, they don't have a Colosseum. Basically, like this, if I give them this edict, that means I should never play a creature. My game plan should be upheaval. So they take the three lands, and then I just take the repulse away from their hand. I mean, I can go like Nightscape Familiar plus land. Will they take that? Yeah, maybe I'll do that instead, and the worst land. And I'm going to take the repulse because there's a bit of redundancy there. And I'm going to crack this to try to find some action here. All right, well, we found a little bit of action, but this is currently our opponent's hand. And I'm glad that we took the repulse because now we can just chain or edict the Nightscape Familiar. Six. Really strange game. I need to find something. 3, 4, 5, 6. I think I'd rather just have more blue sources. I know that's a pain land. I don't want to crack the Colosseum yet. I just want to make sure I have a bunch of mana sources. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Well, now that I have the lands, maybe I should just fire one off. This might have actually been a really aggressive deep analysis. I think I could have waited a turn. Playing a little hasty. I mean, my opponent only has one card in hand. But if they hit like a fact or fiction, it's really bad for us. Or if they play upheaval. Actually, upheaval is not that bad. Four, three cards in hand. I can main phase fact or fiction. I think I'd rather play deep analysis here. Okay. All right. So now we're at that point where we're getting like really far ahead on cards. Yeah, I think that deep analysis is probably a little bit aggressive, but we just have a handful of counters. I just don't want my opponent to know my hand. Counterspell, my counterspell. So now my opponent's hand is two edicts. I could lapse my counterspell just to guarantee that I draw a hard counter.
I think that's actually pretty good.
Like, just making sure you have a handful of hard counters is always good, so... I mean, my opponent's probably just going to take effect here. And then after I draw the counterspell, I'm going to main phase Foth because my opponent has two Chainer's Edicts in hand. This is an interesting one. If my opponent goes like everything fact or fiction, what do I do? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm kind of tempted to just take the big pile here. Just so many lands. But fact or fiction does help me find, like, I want to find a Psychatog plus Upheaval. But we're kind of far away. We still need mana to have that actually be a thing. This is a big decision point, so let me think about it for a little bit longer. Let's see, how many card draw effects have I used? I've used a deep analysis. This is my second fact. I'm just going to take the big land pile. I have faith in my deck. I have faith that we'll outdraw our opponent while already being ahead in cards. Ten. We do not have lethal here. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I'm gonna play out that land so I can go tog. I can go upheaval, psychotog, land, go. But because my opponent has two Chainer's Edicts, we shouldn't play psychotog. What are they gonna get? They already got their effect. I mean, they could get like a mana short, I guess. But mana short's like the only card I can think of. Oh, that's a way to answer my upheaval, actually. Then I should just play out all my lands. Yeah, now we're just waiting for upheaval. Alright, we'll let that resolve and we'll lapse the flashback on it. The thing is, like, also playing out all of our lands is generally okay here because we've used both of our Colosseums, and we might have to upheaval and, like, have this, like, huge counter war. And I can't float mana with upheaval because they have mana short. Let's see, I can go familiar. Tog with counter. Is that good enough? I mean, my opponent does have double edict. Bunch of edicts. I have 21 cards in my graveyard. This might be able to fight through all the edicts, is what I'm trying to get at here. But the question is, will I have lethal? I'll have 24 cards in my graveyard. If this dies and I use some counter magic, that's 12. 30, 40, 15, 16, 17. All right, let's run them out. I'm not going to fight over a repulse. So that's all of their edicts. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, okay. I mean, they likely have creatures in their hand as well. Psychatog? Their hand is like mana short and three cards, right? Go for it. The thing is, my opponent can have a counter here. I could have waited. But I think I really do want to resolve this. So my opponent's logicking my counter spell so that if the mana short resolve, like if I counter back, it doesn't do anything. So I guess I'll just be tapped out. Oh, sure. Yeah, okay. I actually totally missed that. Oh my God, that's really bad. For some reason, I thought my opponent logicked my upheaval or my counter spell. Oh my God. Yeah, that was really bad. No, that was good play by my opponent. I just completely botched that. And of course, we just get incredibly lucky. I'm gonna tap black. Oh, God. It's another counterspell? Oh, they have nothing. Because otherwise they wouldn't let upheaval resolve. They're just floating mana. I guess they could have repulse. And I want to play an untapped land here because I can madness out circular logic. And again, I think if my opponent had counter magic, they would have countered me. So if my opponent plays a repulse here, I'm going to logic it because I want to get aggressive. Yeah, we definitely played this a little bit loose, like a loose goose, for sure. Could have played this a little bit tighter. But we should have the game now. Wow, okay. Way to start out round one with a 50-minute Psychatog mirror. Oh, man. All right, let's pop out the graveyard. Wow. My opponent on the hope I time out strategy here, I guess. It's like, maybe he won't go, maybe he won't go for it. Maybe he's playing around Innocent Blood at instant speed. Got there, folks. Got there. Round one in the books.